All right, it's Debbie Potts, and I am continuing my journey to share you how you can improve your whole self with testing and not guessing on how you should fuel, train, and perform, as well as combining all this data with other functional lab tests, as ideally we can invest in our health doing a stool test to learn about your microbiome. If we could do blood chemistry panel, ideally insurance would cover everything, but they don't. So there's usually things we need to add on Ulta Labs or DHA Labs, or there's own your own lab. So this is one piece of the puzzle. But if we want to improve longevity, we'll go into a little bit more. Part one, I already did a video on this, the VO2 max markers. But as all these different tests, it means nothing. You don't leave that test or leave getting that report with actionable items, right? How many times have you done something? You got a piece of paper and you put it aside in your pile of your health building pile. If you don't know what to do with the data and implement it into your lifestyle, have that as baseline data. It's something you can compare and retest and do again every few months to know if what you're doing is working. And we need to have some baseline data. Where are you right now? Where are you working from? What have you been doing or not doing? What's holding you back from being your best? You don't know unless you have to invest in your health to do some of these tests. So let's continue down talking about metabolic testing. I won't go into me, but you can listen to the other video I did on myself. So blah, blah, blah. That's me, Debbie Potts. Wrote my book, Life's Not a Race. You can learn more about it and the Holistic Method Manual. I've done 15 Ironmans and retired because I got adrenal exhaustion. And this is why I do what I do today, to help other high performers, overachiever, driven individuals, athletes of all levels, to improve the aging process so you don't break down and burn out your body systems as I did. So you can learn more on the website, debbiepotts.net, and read my book on Amazon if you want to know what happens when you do too much of everything. So more is not better. Too much of anything can be toxic. Too little of anything can lead to deficiencies. We need to look at our genetics, epigenetics, and this whole domino effect of happens when we do too much of everything. So that's the old me, but then I've learned how to do things differently. So what we're looking at now is how can we improve the aging process? What are we knowing? What happens as we get older? We get slower, we get sarcopenia, we lose our muscle mass, we lose our balance, we have trouble stepping up and over curbs, mobility, pulling on your pants, putting your shoes on, just activities of daily life. And as I am in Palm Desert at my mom's house and seeing how she moves and all of her friends move and all the health issues everyone's having when they get in their late 70s and 80s, this is a choice. I believe a lot of it. And we can control some things we can, obviously, but what can we work on changing? We know we lose, as I said, strength, our metabolism slows down, metabolic efficiency, but we can increase all this with how we train. If we have the right tools in our toolbox and make it simple, not complicated. So, key concepts I want to review: metabolic health. Metabolic health is the overall state of an individual's metabolism, range of physiological processes related to how your body converts food into energy, synthesizes and breaks down nutrients, and regulates blood sugar, lipid levels, and other metabolic markers. A person with a healthy metabolism can efficiently convert food into energy to support basic physiological processes. Metabolic health typically translates to stable levels of glucose, insulin, which you have to ask get tested. They're not testing that in your insurance. Lipids in the blood, healthy body weight, low levels of inflammation, oxidative stress, and other metabolic disturbances. These items are all important. And I skipped over here. But what is metabolic health? Metabolic health, lumen.com. Lumen can measure metabolic flexibility. Had a great blog out today to cover this. just in time for the, these slides I was putting together. What is VO2 max? VO2 max, we'll talk about again, measure of your body's maximal rate of oxygen consumption. Bradley Holmer has a great book I need to order, but I was listening to him on podcasts and signed up for his blog. But when we are exercising or just sitting down for that matter, a body takes in air from the lungs, distributes it throughout the body via the heart, the blood vessels, then pulls oxygen from that blood into our muscles, into our tissues, into our cells. We're there. Our mitochondria uses it to produce energy in the form of ATP. So VO2 max is what we keep hearing about. Why? It's correlated with longevity, with all-cause mortality. VO2 max is measured the max amount of oxygen you can utilize during intense exercise, reflection of your cardiovascular fitness, and the efficiency of your oxygen delivery system to the working muscles. A higher VO2 max level is often associated, this is why we keep hearing about this, to better cardiovascular health, lower risk of chronic diseases as heart disease, diabetes, and of course, result is improved longevity. Quality of life is what I'm looking for. A longer, better, high quality life. Individuals with a higher VO2 max tend to have a better endurance level, lower resting heart rate, and improved overall physical function contributes to longevity. So we can look at genetic SNPs, a whole list of ones I've found, to your VO2 max. We can look at other markers as your metabolic flexibility, metabolic efficiency. So the Krebs cycle, can't see the whole picture, but it's very confusing. There's a lot going on. Look at the word NAD. It's probably why we see NAD everywhere. It's evolved in this whole energy cycle to create ATP. What is metabolic flexibility? We'll talk about that because when we're measuring your fat, carbohydrate burn, calories burn in a metabolism test, we're also looking at your metabolic flexibility. This is the ability of the body to switch fuel sources, carbohydrates and fats. Not protein, but carbs and fats, based on the energy demands and availability. This includes ability to adjust insulin sensitivity, mitochondria function, and substrate utilization in response to changes in nutrient availability and energy requirements. So we can go into that more, but it's more the switch, carbs to fat, fats to carbs, depending on the activity level. Your dietary intake is not just about diet and exercise. It's deeply rooted in efficiency of the mitochondria and influenced by various mediators processes in your body. This is from Lumen, who does the breath test. Mitochondria, often referred to the powerhouses of the cells, are where carbohydrates and fats are oxidized to produce energy. The ability of mitochondria to switch between fuel sources without inefficiency is crucial for maintaining energy balance and supporting metabolic health. Enhanced mitochondria function facilitates a smoother transition between glucose and fatty acids as fuel, supporting the essence of metabolic flexibility. So again, metabolic flexibility, a flexible body can switch between fuel sources for optimal performance and efficiency. This allows you to maintain energy balance, optimize body composition, and protect against metabolic diseases. So it's important to know if you are metabolically flexible or inflexible. What does it mean when you are inflexible? It occurs when the body's unable to adapt its metabolic processes appropriately in response to changes in its nutrient availability or energy demands. This may manifest as impaired glucose tolerance, reduced ability to switch between fuel sources, and dysregulation of insulin sensitivity. This is crucial to have flexibility to maintain metabolic health. When the body can efficiently switch fuel sources, it's better equipped to maintain stable blood sugar levels, manage energy expenditure, and prevent excessive fat storage. This adaptability can support overall metabolic health and can help prevent metabolic disorders as insulin resistance, which is the precursor to type 2 diabetes and obesity. So again, the metabolic flexibility is that switching. And a sign of good metabolic health with positive health outcomes is what we want to look at. So can we see, how do we see if you're metabolically flexible? How are you able to switch fuel sources at rest and during exercise, tapping into your fat stores when carb availability is limited? But also, if you have some carbohydrates, are you able to be able to metabolism? So it doesn't mean avoid carbohydrates. I think what I've seen over the years is we need to have flexibility, right? Same with heart rate variability. We don't want to be parasympathetic all the time. We want to have sympathetic dominance to avoid sympathetic dominance, but have flexibility to shift back and forth. We don't want to be inflexible that we can't burn carbohydrates. We need to burn fat and carbohydrates and switch back and forth. So Lumen in their blog post today had this interesting picture. What happens when you eat healthy food? High carb foods are high in sugar, so avoiding the high carb processed foods, but getting good protein, the carbs, healthy fats, stabilizing your blood sugar. So I always like to say what I learned in nutritional therapy: eat real nutrient dense whole foods, one ingredient type of food that balances your blood sugar, stabilizes your glucose, right? So using Nutrisense or Lumen tests your breath if you're burning fat or carbohydrates, but also managing your blood sugar levels using Nutrisense levels. Now, Lumen shows you here, increased carb intake promotes less fat burn. There's also weight gain. Metabolic flexibility is decreased over time, weight gain, and no metabolic flexibility leads to insulin resistance. So you can use Lumen. Don't buy it without a discount code. So ask me if you want one. I can get a discount code. I might have one. So it's an interesting way to test your metabolic flexibility. Now, when I use Pinoy metabolic testing, we can do this at resting tests. It's a 10-minute test. Now, metabolically flexible versus inflexible, what ratio of nutrient-dense whole foods are eating? How is that creating energy? Or are you storing? So how much food you eat will be converted into useful energy and fat, depending on how effectively your tissues respond to available nutrients, your intake. So the more metabolically flexible you are, the more your tissues can respond to the food intake. So that's the definition from Pinoy, using food as energy versus converting it into excess fat. So metabolic efficiency, again, the body utilize food. How well your body converts to the energy obtained from food and use it rather than store it. So what we look at, figure out if you're metabolically efficient. What is your BMR, your basal metabolic rate? This is the amount of energy expended to the body at rest to maintain basic physiological functions as breathing, circulation, cell repair. A higher BMR indicates a greater metabolic efficiency as the body is expending more energy even at rest. Nutrient utilization. We want to have efficient metabolism that's involved in optimal breakdown utilization of macronutrients, carbs, fat, and proteins from food for energy production, tissue repair, and other metabolic processes. Then we also want to look at the mitochondria. Mitochondria are the powerhouses we hear all the time. We need another word. Everyone says powerhouses. Responsible for producing ATP, our primary energy currency. Efficient mitochondrial function is essential for converting nutrients into usable functions. So this is what we test, basal metabolic rate, in our Pinoy metabolic testing. What genetics impact that? There's a big list, so you can look at that at your genetic reports. The Wild Health Clarity Report will might use some of these. So we want to look at longevity. How is metabolic efficiency working with longevity? Metabolic flexibility versus inefficiency, again, and look at that. Then we look at metabolic health. Metabolic health, what does that mean? Blood sugar levels, your insulin sensitivity, your lipid panel, blood pressure, and inflammation markers, all important indicators of metabolic health. Now, this is my problem lately. C-reactive protein isn't tested. So here are the markers we want to look at. A1C, insulin is never, rarely ever tested. unless you ask, and you might have to pay extra, which is $10 to $20 on these websites where you can go get your own labs at LabCorp. Lipid profile. We don't want to look at total cholesterol, LDL, HDL, triglycerides as much anymore. We want to look at the ApoB. We want to look at the particle size, LDL little a. I have that on the next slide. CRP is never tested either, rarely, unless you ask. Looking at ALT, AST, and GGT for liver and your fat, how efficient you're burning fat. We look at apoapenin and leptin, and fasting ketones can be looked at. What lipid markers do you want to see? Ideally, we want to get LDLP, particle size and density, HDL, triglyceride HDL, you'll see ApoB, ApoA, and lipoprotein A, LP little a. Elevated levels of LPA are considered independent risk factor for cardiovascular disease. LP little a promotes atherosclerosis and thrombosis. Measuring levels can help identify individuals high risk. So if your doctor, as Dr. Matt Dawson said on my podcast the other day, isn't testing this whole profile, they're still looking at just LDL, HDL, triglyceride, cholesterol, you need to see a new doctor. That's what he said. Genetic markers that are involved in metabolic health. Here's a list. Okay. So breathing tests, the Prinoy test you can find. It's portable. You might find, look up someone near you, or I can come to you if there's a group of people. Prinoy resting and active test is a way to find out your resting metabolism and your active metabolic rate with a breath analysis. So Prinoy means breath. It's a Greek company using Greek words. Breath. VO2 max is what we're looking at, but also so many other markers. So that's not the only thing we want to look at for longevity. VO2 max. I wanted to cover that. When we do the metabolism testing, we're looking at biological age by looking at metabolic health, fat burn efficiency, your metabolism, and your VO2 max. Your VO2 max and VO2 peak. We're measuring your lung fitness, heart rate variabilities, your heart fitness, metabolic rate, fat burn, and your recovery. So we go high heart rate, how fast does your heart rate come down? And we can figure out your training zones. So the biomarkers are in a report that you get back afterwards. And then a key thing we want to look at when we're looking at your zone two that everyone talks about is called the respiratory exchange ratio, or RER, or also known as RQ. It's the ratio of carbon dioxide to oxygen. So the RER, VO2 divided by CO2, we want to look at those markers. So the RER closer to 0.7 indicates that fats are the primary fuel source. RER closer to 0.8 to 0.85 is the mixture of fat carbs. Closer to 1.0 indication of carbs are the primary fuel source. So we can see this on the test where your fat is highest and then where your carbohydrates increase. So what other markers are we looking at to improve VO2 max? So why do we focus so much on VO2 max? It's a critical metric for longevity and plays a key role in measuring cardiorespiratory fitness, how well the body can use oxygen during intense exercise, and that correlates with health span, lifespan, and brain health. You can improve your VO2 max with both high intensity interval training and steady state activities as zone two. Regular exercise activities can enhance VO2 max, but they also can affect heart health, brain function, as well as longevity. But to me, what I keep talking about with my athletes and on this podcast is that regular exercise, what does that mean? How much is too much? Because a lot of people are doing too much, causing oxidative stress. Okay, so VO2 max definition, we went over, but how is it determined? Milliliters of oxygen absorbed per minute divided by kilograms of body weight. Negative impact of excessive body weight can have impact on your health. So the higher your body weight is after a certain threshold, the higher chance of chronic conditions. So the numerator reflects how effectively your oxygen chain works. So the combination of the three systems is what we're looking at: your lungs, your heart, and your cells. So VO2 max is so important to tell us how healthy we are because we're looking at these three markers. So VO2 max is a maximum rate or your peak, which an individual can consume oxygen during intense exercise. This reflects your body's ability to transport oxygen from the atmosphere to the working muscles and utilize it for energy production. Typically expressed, as we just said, milliliters per kilogram per minute, measure of cardiovascular aerobic fitness. Higher the VO2 max levels, if better aerobic capacity endurance. This is influenced by genetics, age, sex, and training status. So, again, VO2, VCO2, we can find out your calories, your fat, and carb through these formulas: calories, RER, carbs, percentage of carbs, carbs versus fats. So, we can get all this information by doing a metabolic test. Why do you want to know your VO2? How can you improve it? Interesting chart I found. Chronic disease risk, extremely low at the top, very high at the bottom. VO2 max at 25 to a 65. VO2 max in your 70s. Interesting aerobic exercise. Is your aerobic capacity, but do you need some sprints? Do you need some zone two? Do you need just movement throughout the day? What impacts our VO2 max? Because if you want to improve the length of a longer life, but again, quality of life is a key word. We want to predict your VO2 max or test it. Why? And how do you improve it? So higher VO2 max linked to better cardiovascular health, lower blood pressure, improved lipid profiles, reduced risk of cardiovascular disease, heart attack, stroke, strengthening your heart muscle, enhancing blood vessel function, reducing inflammation, all contribute to longevity. So we can look at your longevity and biological age with your VO2 max health prediction, looking at how you are based on your, well, this one, actual age versus biological age on the PNOE test is using three markers: your VO2 peak, your fat burn capability, and your metabolism, metabolic rate. And then other charts I found interesting. As we age, VO2 max, and this says red lines low fitness, average, high fitness. So the higher fitness is green, so the more we want to stay active as we get older. So does a longer quality life correlate with the higher VO2 max? How do you do it? When you do PNOE metabolic testing, we can determine your peak fat burning zone and your metabolic crossover point, which will help determine your current zone two with your heart rate. You got to wear your heart rate monitor, chest strap when you exercise. This will help improve your fat burning efficiency, cellular fitness, and lower obesity risk. If you add in, there's missing a T there, zone four and five training, not raining, you can improve VO2 max, improve testosterone, and enhance lung function. These are intervals we'll talk about later. Coming down to zone one, up to zone four, zone five. And then we really want to look at, which I think gets forgotten in here when we're talking about VO2 max, is strength training. Definitely need to find a balance between resistance training to improve the aging process. I don't like to focus on VO2 max sprint training, that it's not the only part. It's one part, again, of the puzzle. It's not the only thing you should be focusing on is VO2 max by doing cardio 4x4 workouts or the 10 by 1 minute workouts. Sprint, zone two, and resistance training and recovery, mobility, stability, yoga. So don't forget that VO2 max is just one part of what you should be working on if you're a health optimizer. So to improve, what numbers do you want to strive for? 10-year survival rate, risk of death from any cause. So higher the number, VO2 max, top 2%, 10-year risk mortality improves 97%, lower risk of death, 80%. Amazing. 10-year survival measured middle age in the 50s. That's where we are. Risk reduction over 10 years. Another graph I found online. Sedentary versus trained. It's why our parents need to be working out and lifting weights. So, summarization of VO2 max longevity. VO2 max longer strongest predictor of your athletic performance improvement. But by understanding the VO2 max, you have a clear measure of aerobic capacity and your potential. So this is where we can tailor your program along with the other clues that we collect to figure out what you need to do to be your best self in the future. We also look at VO2 max and metabolic health, how that will help lower or help rather improve insulin sensitivity, glucose metabolism. Aerobic exercise increases VO2 max, improves insulin sensitivity, enhances glucose uptake by the muscles, and helps regulate blood sugar levels, promoting longevity. We also hear a lot about the brain-derived neurofactors. So BDNF is improved. So we have this higher VO2 max on brain health and longevity with more increased cerebral blood flow, neurogenesis, synaptic plasticity. Telomere length and cellular aging. Higher VO2 max associated with longer telomeres, indicating slower cellular aging and greater cellular longevity. So exercise aerobic fitness may preserve telomere length through various mechanisms by reducing oxidative stress, inflammation, DNA damage. But here's that Goldilocks effect. How much exercise? More is not better. This oxidative stress, inflammation, DNA damage is also, I would suggest and predict, going to happen if you do too much intense exercise and duration. So there's this fine line that's not in these articles in the literature of moderate amount of exercise to improve VO2 max versus excessive, which is most of us listening. So measuring your VO2 max, we could do it on a bike. It's a mask. Measure it up, hook it up, it's on your backpack. And we can analyze the gases you're breathing through this device here. And your analyzer is in the backpack. My picture in this device. So VO2 max testing, it's also known as cardiopulmonary exercise testing, cardiometabolic analysis, analyzing three parts, lungs, hearts, and cells involved in oxygen absorption, transfer, and utilization. So lungs, heart, and cells. So again, we are looking at these different markers. Oops, we already saw that get in here. So improving your VO2 max, how can we do that? How can we improve your age? So looking at the charts again, what is optimal, and then figure out what workouts. So once we determine what are your five training zones, what workouts should you do? VO2 max works at workouts. A 4x4, I keep hearing about every day, but 4 minutes at what heart rate? What does that 85 to 90% mean for you? And what does that recovery in zone one mean to you? Are you measuring with a heart rate strap, or are you just going by perceived exertion level? Tabata's 20 seconds on, 10 seconds off, 8 rounds. Fartlek training, 10 to 15 minutes, like cardio warm-up, and then you go periods of high intensity, sprinting to low intensity. So I was doing this kind of sort of the other day, running to the swim soon. All right, there's a light pole. I'm gonna keep going until I hit that light pole. But recovery in between these is essential. Zone one, back up to zone four or five. Research I shared last time, there's some different ones. Consistency, hitting that number, not losing the power in those 4 minute pieces, I think is important. Other research on sprint versus high volume interval training versus periodization interval training. And what did they find? Increases in VO2 max in response to HIIT regimens are due to improvements in oxygen delivery pre and post HIIT across all training groups. Let's see. Yeah, so those are the different tasks that they did. So interesting to see a little bit improvements in oxygen delivery, which one helped the best. Pre-run intervals, steady state endurance training, hill repeats. Those are other options I found. So what's best for you? Now this is another study. Confirm that HIIT and SIT protocols were similar gains. Your choice of the protocol can be made for convenience. 19 studies in this meta-analysis. So that's when I was looking at. They're combining all these different systemic review meta-analysis, looking at HIIT versus SIT, which ones are best. So do what works best for you. But then Dr. Stacey Sims says for older women, we might do best with sprints, 20 seconds. So we are different. So you can look at all that research and then zoning. What is your zone one? We figure out your five zones in our metabolic testing. We want to figure out where you are burning fat to carbohydrates, that RER. Figure out where your fuel switches are, how you're burning fat to carbohydrates, where your metabolic crossover point is, how well you are oxidizing fat. That confusing Krebs cycle here has a whole picture. But fat oxidation is a slower process compared to glycolysis and is a primary energy source during low to moderate exercise. So zone one and two are your fat burning. When you get zone three, a little more carbohydrates. Zone four and zone five is more creatine phosphate. So we have different fuel sources. It should be flipped around, lactate, and then creatine phosphate's at that high intensity. So how do we use that? Glucose is converted to pyruvate and then into lactate, generating ATP without oxygen. But lactate can be used as a fuel source by the muscles, so it can be reused, transported to the liver, converted back to glucose, gluconeogenesis. So the metabolism of lactate does not directly generate ATP, but rather helps maintain energy balance and support continued exercise performance. So it's not a metabolic waste product, as we used to say, lactic acid, but it's lactate that's used for another energy source, can be used by muscles in the tissues at higher intensities. So women, we want to test before your cycle or before ovulation, kind of right in the second week. So maybe your third week, but not probably first or fourth. So looking at the fuel sourcing, we personalize it, figure out which fuels to use again, and go into all that with you. So aerobic, all this information we talk about, performance, fat loss, and what you can do. So let me know if you have any questions. This is where we can dial in what you need to do and then combine that with all the other data we can collect in the coaching program. So see if you have questions, head to the website to learn more, how to improve longevity, performance, figure out your zones, and more. So we'll talk to you next time. Thanks for listening. And let me know your questions.